Good morning. Why don't you stand to your feet with us? We're going to sing Joy to the World. Let's do it.
Son, to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Purify our conscience, Almighty God, by your daily visitation, that your Son Jesus Christ, at his coming, may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. That's so beautiful. Purify our conscience so that when your Son returns, he can find a mansion prepared for himself. Amen. God, would you come and dwell here with us? We invite you. Prepare us in a way that you would prepare a house to live in. Won't you make us hosts of your presence, hosts of your spirit. That's our prayer this morning. We hail your arrival this morning. We're grateful for your coming. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just say out of your mouth, thank you, Jesus. Amen. Let's sing.
Who is God that he would take our friend?
Adore him. Oh, come let let's sing it one more time. Oh, come let us adore. It's why we're here. Sing, oh, come let us adore. We adore you, Jesus. Oh, come let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. Christ the Lord, our Emmanuel is with us. God with us. God, we thank you so much for your son, Jesus. We're grateful for that beautiful gift of his example. Would you just posture your heart this morning in gratitude, however you need to do that. If you need to sit, you can sit. If you need to stand, you can stand. If you need to kneel, you can kneel. But can we just take on, adopt a position of gratitude this morning? Jesus, we're thankful for who you are, for who you were, and for who you will be. Come on, let's sing. Our peace this morning. Our Emmanuel, he's God with us. Our Jesus that came to be with us, to be one of us. Not because he wanted to stoop as low as that, but because he wanted to give us an example of what it's like to be fully human all the way, completely human. And that's a miracle. So today we turn our eyes upon Jesus and we look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth that are backwards and don't necessarily match up with what we think should be will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Amen. So today we look at you, Jesus. We turn our eyes on you. And we don't look side to side. Our shepherd king, what a backwards thing to say. What a backwards thing to be. Our shepherd king, you're watching over us. So when things look backwards in our lives, when things look backwards in our homes and in our jobs and in our commute and in our pockets, we know you're watching over us. Because we don't live in this system. We don't live in this kingdom. We live in your kingdom. So won't you take everything that we have and everything that we are and use it, spend it, mold it, grow it, totally waste it on whatever you want to use it for here in your kingdom, and help us to walk that out this morning and as we go from here. Jesus, we're grateful for you. Amen. You can be seated. Continue. Just would you stay in that attitude of worship as we ask the ushers to come for the giving of tithes and offerings. You have four ways to give. You can give in a bag as it comes by. There's boxes at the front as well as you leave. There are also opportunities to give online on our website, oasischurch.org/give, or you can also give on the app. But this morning, Would you take that with you? I feel that so heavy, just that we live in a system that is highly capitalized. And Jesus didn't operate in that system. He was a shepherd king. And if things look a little strange to you, if they look a little backward, I still encourage you to give your best gift, the best gift from your pocket, but also the best gift of yourself. Would you work on yourself and practice self-care and practice the best giving of yourself to others and to your family and to back to God? Amen? Amen. So give cheerfully this morning.
The Advent wreath is a circle with no beginning and no end. It is a symbol of endless love and faithfulness. Out of darkness, light shines, pointing us in hope to the one who came to overcome the darkness of this world and to be our light in the world to come. The fourth candle in the Advent wreath represents love. It is a symbol of the generous, unconditional, burning love of Christ that has been freely given to us. May this light remind us that we are a light in the world and that the world will know us by that same love. A reading from the book of Isaiah. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary mortals that you weary my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel." Dear strong and mighty God, by the power of the Spirit who created the earth and everything in it, create in us pure hearts and renew within us steadfast spirits that the love fulfilled in Bethlehem may more and more permeate our lives until we share fully in your glory. In the name of the King who comes and is coming again, we pray. Amen.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, everyone.
Merry Christmas. Almost. Almost Christmas. Hey, we just want to say welcome to everybody, and we want to say a very special welcome to those of you who are visiting with us today. If this is your first time, or if you've recently started attending, we want to say hello, and we want to let you know that we're grateful that you're here, that we're thinking about you, we're praying about you, and to show you that, we have a special gift for you. So all you have to do to receive that gift is if you'll reach into the seat backs in front of you, there's a communication card. If you'll take a few moments to fill that out and drop it off at the welcome desk, that way we know how to get in touch with you. We can stay, keep you informed on what's going on. And we'll also be able to give you one of those special gifts to let you know that we're praying for you and we're glad that you're here today. So
I'm going to throw a curveball in.
Sure,
really quick.
Yeah, go for it.
I'd like to
what
say thank you. I know, right? I'd like to say thank you to everyone that came out last night. We went Christmas caroling, and we had a great time, and we got to sing for some people who really appreciated it, and one household that did not appreciate it. But that's okay. We're going to pray for those people that at some point during this Christmas season, they do get a little bit of joy during the holidays.
Yeah, for sure. And speaking of Christmas, we have our annual Christmas Eve service that's on Christmas Eve of all. Imagine that. It's on Christmas Eve. But December the 24th, we're going to get together. We're going to have our candlelight service. It's going to start at 5:30 p.m. The whole family's invited. Come on out. We're going to kind of mark the end of the Advent season, mark the end of our expectation, and celebrate the arrival of our long-awaited Savior. So 5:30 here at Oasis. Be sure to be there. We'd love to celebrate that with you. And it's not a long service. It's a pretty brief service, but it's a time for us to be together as a family. And it's early and brief enough for you to also go and celebrate Christmas Eve with your family as well. So we hope you can join us for that.
The diaper drive is still going on, everyone. Next week is the last week to bring diapers for one more child. It's a great organization. Their goal is to get 1 million diapers donated and everything. So we're trying to do our part. Diapers are going to foster families, single moms, and pregnancy centers. Last week, I made a joke about older people wearing diapers, but you're not going to hear that from me today. Well, you might hear it today. It depends. Thank you.
That was good. Hey, for those of you groaning, he doesn't care.
Me and Mikhail, we have a thing where we don't really want the laugh. We want the
Yeah, I'm going for gasps. But and during this Christmas season, we all want to let you know that the offices are going to be closed for the week of Christmas. So this Monday through Friday, the offices will be closed. But fear not, if you need to get in touch with us, if you need anything from the pastoral staff or from the church staff and leaders of the church, you can still call in. The church phone will still be answered. So, you know, don't hesitate to call us if there's anything. You know, well, maybe hesitate to call, but you know what I mean. Like, if you need anything, go ahead and give us a call, and we will be there to answer the phone for you. So, hey, Upstreet Kids, y'all in here?
Yeah.
Yep. No?
Yep.
Yeah.
Upstreet Kids, are you here?
Yeah!
Hey, right,
there
it is.
You needed to hear it.
Y'all can stand up. Cap and Sean are waving right now. We're going to walk you to your classrooms. And if you are not an Upstreet Kid, look at each other and tell each other that y'all are the best thing that y'all have seen all week.
Why don't you go ahead and stand up and greet a neighbor. Wish them a Merry Christmas.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. You're very good at meeting and greeting. Yes, I was going to say that. We're going to open up this portion of our service actually returning to that text that Ashley just read in our call to worship. It's from Isaiah, and it's toward the beginning. This is kind of Isaiah's, well, I was going to say it's Isaiah's first prophecy. Maybe it's his first professional prophecy. He'd been prophesying a little bit in chapters 1 through 5, mostly kind of calling out the neighbor countries for not behaving well. Excuse me. But then in chapter 6, he has this experience after the king had died, Uriah died, and he'd gone to the temple, and you're familiar with that. But this passage is maybe a little less familiar, although it does contain one verse that sounds very Christmassy. In the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, the king of Judah, the king Rezin of Aram, and the king Pekah, the son of Remaliah of Israel, went out to attack Jerusalem. Let me jump down just a bit. Where did I say I was going to begin? That wasn't it. Oh, I found it. It's verse 10. Get a mulligan? I'm in chapter 7, verse 10. But I'm glad to bring out that other stuff about all those names I had a hard time pronouncing. We'll come back to them. Again, the Lord said to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test. Sounds like a good thing. Didn't Jesus say to Satan not to test the Lord your God? It's part of Matthew's account. Yeah, I'll not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to worry mortals that you weary my God too? Not sure what you're so upset about. He says then, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey, and by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, for before the child knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted. Now, I don't know about the rest of you, that's not necessarily the easiest thing to understand. Like, I read that, and then I reread it. And sometimes I read different passages than I didn't intend to read. And I have to kind of, in a way, give Ahaz, the king of Judah, a bit of a pass. Like, I get it. So, when Isaiah had been called in the previous chapter, he's told that he'll speak, but they'll have eyes that can't see and ears that can't hear and hearts that can't understand, lest they turn and be saved, which is kind of a horrible thing to tell a prophet, that no one's going to listen to what you have to say, no one's going to see you as a prophet, and what you have to say is going to be ineffective. Well, apparently that part of the prophecy is coming clear here. Right, he's speaking to Ahaz, but Ahaz is not listening. Ahaz is not paying attention. Ahaz is not responding in any way that we might deem as faithful. And so Isaiah speaks kind of judgment on him. But in the previous chapter again, when Isaiah said, well, how long, O Lord, how long will it be like that? How long will people not recognize me? How long will my ministry be ineffective? Because that didn't sound too cool. God says, well, there'll be a remnant, right? There'll be a small group. I mean, maybe that's like the child, right? There's a little bit of hope. There's something going on. But just just before Isaiah has a chance to be relieved whatsoever, God says, but then the remnant shall be destroyed. The city shall be laid waste. But there's a seed in the stump. Excuse me? Thank you? What? God said to Isaiah, there's a seed in the stump. So Isaiah is now called to prophesy, and he comes into the king's court, and he says, you can ask for anything, as low as hell, as high as heaven, ask for anything. And the king's like, no, I'm not going to ask. I'm not going to put the Lord to the test. And Isaiah is like, how dare you? Maybe he's a little miffed, like, I'm the man of God. I'm here to give you something, and you're not willing to take it? Like, you take from people, will you not take from God? I don't know how to read that part. But then what Isaiah says to the king sounds about as understandable as what God had said to Ahaz, right? So God's like to Isaiah, you're going to be a prophet because there's a seed in the stump. The prophet now says to the king, you're going to be judged because a woman's going to have a baby. Thanks for laughing. Because if that makes sense to you, I should have talked to you before this sermon. So you could have explained it to me. It's like a young woman's going to have a baby, and the baby's going to, you know, drink milk and have honey, you know, the land of milk and honey. Things are going to be nice and good, sweet and pure, right? Provision. But before the child's old enough to embrace the good and reject the evil, the king of Assyria is going to come and destroy these two other kings that you're so worried about that are threatening you. So in that bit of the scripture that I didn't intend to read, that's the part of the passage that actually tells us that the king of Judah is between a rock and a hard place. He's got his back up against the wall. The two kings to his north have said, we're going to come and destroy you unless you join us to fight the Assyrians, which seems like a lose-lose situation. No one should sign up to fight the Assyrians because they're the most powerful country in the world at the time, except that you have two countries bigger than you saying, if you don't join us, we're going to attack you first before we go attack them. So he is in a tight spot. But this message is not good news, because the king of Assyria is going to come and destroy Syria and Ephraim, right, the kingdoms of the north. But then they're also going to come and lay Judah waste. And eventually that will happen. So the list of kings, Shalmaneser, Tiglath-Pileser III, and then Sennacherib. Those are good names too. I used to think that if I had a dog, I would name him Tiglath-Pileser III. Just so that people could say, what's your dog's name? And I'd say, Tiglath-Pileser III. And they'd think, oh yeah, the king of Assyria. But that message, right, a young woman shall give birth to a baby, and we shall call the baby Emmanuel. Well, we know how Matthew reads that story, and that's why we read that story this time of year. But before we jump to Matthew, let's just pause and think about a couple of possibilities that it might mean in Isaiah's context. One possibility is the very next chapter, chapter 8, a baby is born, and it is the son of the prophet. So he says a young woman's going to give birth to a baby, and the very next chapter, a young woman gives birth to a baby. And you can hear it right now. A young woman gives birth to the baby, and it's the child of the prophet. His name is Meher Shalah Hashbaz. Another good one. Little side note, this is very self-indulgent, so forgive me. But it does remind me. I was in my very first, this is going to explain to you so much about who I am. I was in my very first day of seminary. Like my very first day, my very first class. And it was an introduction to the Old Testament. And the professor was explaining the class, and he was saying, you know, this is an overview, right? This is to explain to you the long, large arc of this narrative, how the whole fits together, the major genres, the major themes. This is not, you know, kind of getting into the minutia. This is not about trivia. You know, that's not what this course is about. I'm not going to ask you who's the second son of Isaiah. And I'm like, me. He's like, yes. I'm like, Mahershalal Hashbaz. He's like, what? I'm like, that's the name of Isaiah's second son. He's like, right. Do you have a question? Yeah, I was just really eager. I've tried to grow out of that. Because too often I think when we come to the faith, we think it's about knowing something. Like there's some secret key, there's some secret knowledge, and if you can just know it just right, if you can say it just right, then maybe we can get God to do something. As though God's waiting on us to say the right words, or God's waiting on us to kneel the right way. That somehow God is a trickster, really. But that's not it at all. There is this son of the prophet that is born. And in some ways, the idea of a prophet having a son or a child is this idea of the continuing voice of God amongst the people, right? That is kind of God with us. But the idea that God is with us is only kind of helpful. It's only consoling in certain ways, right? Because we still face troubles. We still face trials. Things aren't great. I mean, Assyria is still out there. And here they come. And they destroy the nations just to our north. And they eventually destroy most of Judah until Sennacherib has Hezekiah kind of pinned into Jerusalem. In fact, it's one of the oldest pieces of kind of extra-biblical evidence that we have. It's an archaeological find of a pillar that was found in Nineveh. And on it is in kind of a particular script called cuneiform. On it is this comment about Sennacherib. Like it's one of the kind of few things we found outside of the Bible or outside of kind of Jewish circles that correlate the story. So what's interesting is if you're reading the pillar, which is it's now in the British Museum in London. If you're reading it, what it says, Sennacherib says that he had Hezekiah pinned in Jerusalem like a bird in a cage. Well, what Kings, you know, the book of Kings tells the same story, and it says that God came and the angel of the Lord delivered them, and that Sennacherib had to go home because 120,000 of his troops had died. Kind of two different accounts. Yeah. But some people read Isaiah and they think that maybe the son to be born is not the prophet's son who's born in the next chapter, which I think is the most natural reading of the text, but the king's son. Because while we're not told immediately of the birth of Ahaz's son, Ahaz's son will come and he'll bring a revival. Ahaz's son is Hezekiah, the one who kind of returns Judah to the worship of God. So there's all this kind of language, and there's all these kind of possible interpretations that seem not unreasonable. The prophet says a baby's going to be born, a baby is born. Well, maybe that's the fulfillment of the prophecy. But then there's another baby that's born that also brings about good things. So maybe that's the fulfillment of the prophecy. And I think that's how the Word of God comes to us. It's always coming to us in kind of new and fresh ways. It always has some kind of potential to open up something creative, some future that we couldn't have imagined, some spark of hope that we couldn't have conjured up ourselves, that this word of prophecy is never kind of exhausted. It's never something like, oh, you know, Scripture says this or God says this, and now there's that, and I've got it, and that settles it. That way of being in the world, I think, imagines a level of certainty that is actually unfaithful to the Christian faith. Like, God is not something or someone that you just get, right? That you just understand, that you just can then predict or utilize. So there's a passage that when this passage gets quoted in Matthew, let's turn there. It's Matthew chapter 1, he says with a certain amount of confidence, beginning in verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, when his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they had lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel. He's quoting that passage from Isaiah 7, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had born a son, and he named him Jesus. So Isaiah apparently takes this prophecy that was prophesied to King Ahaz, and he says this is being fulfilled not with the birth of Meher Shalah Hashbaz, right? It's not the birth of the prophet. It's not the birth of Hezekiah, but it's the birth of Jesus. Or maybe a better way to say it is not either or, but rather both and. That is, that the prophecy that Isaiah originally delivered to Ahaz, which seems to be kind of completely a judgment, right? A baby's going to be born, and before he's old enough to really know right from wrong, this king of Assyria is going to come, and he's going to cut them down, and he's going to cut you down. All right, that's not so good. But here, we get that message that a baby is going to be born. And as we know from the rest of the story, that is not good news for Herod. And it's not good news for Caesar. And it's not good news for any of our systems or our ways of being in the world that are anti-God. But his coming is a coming that doesn't just kind of cut and kill and destroy, but his coming is a coming that makes whole, that restores, that creates new. I find it interesting, these two characters in these stories, right? Ahaz and Joseph. I feel bad for Ahaz. I do. Like, I'm not exactly sure how he was supposed to respond to such a quirky word. I mean, he's the king of a country. He's got some responsibilities. Some guy strolls in and says, I've got a word of the Lord for you. I mean, what would you do? If somebody came to you in your life and said, I had a word of the Lord for you, some of you might be ready to receive. Others might think, what you got? You got something that can help? And then the person who has this word of the Lord for you says, a baby's going to be born. He's going to drink milk and honey. Yes, that's what babies do, right? All babies, they drink milk. It's a pretty natural baby thing. It's just, it's practically incomprehensible. And I think that's sometimes how I feel. Like, I look around at the world, and it's hard for me to comprehend that things are the way they are. Because sometimes I see people who are pretty unjust, that live like kings. And I see people who are pretty diligent, that suffer. And I want things to be different. And I'm wondering, what can I do? And so Ahaz, I think, got caught in between all that. And then there's Joseph. And I think at least initially, Joseph is almost exactly like Ahaz. I mean, he's not a king. But a word of the Lord is coming to him that I feel like is practically incomprehensible. Not altogether, but it sure is tough. Joseph, your fiance is pregnant. That's not good news. Right? That's not good news. Your fiance is pregnant and you haven't slept with your fiance. That's the other part of that story. So we all know what that means, right? If you're engaged to be married and you find out that the other person's having a baby and you've yet to have sex with them, there's no way to comprehend that in any way other than this is bad news. And so it says Joseph was going to put her away. He was going to divorce her. I mean, that's what you would do. I mean, what do you want him to do? Say, ah, shucks, it's okay. So his initial response seems to be fairly similar to Ahaz's, right? They are both kind of working within the realm of kind of natural, you know, possibilities. The best wisdom, right, that you might have. But I think what we're called to, and this is where Scripture refers to Joseph as a righteous man. Now, it says he's righteous, and then it says that he, you know, obeyed the kind of commandment of the angel. And sometimes I've heard that reduced, that righteousness is obedience, at least for Matthew. But I think there's something else for us to tease out of this story. And this is what I hope we might take away today as we kind of bring this Advent season this year to a close. And that is, it's okay not to know. Like, I don't think Ahaz knew what to do. I don't think Joseph knew what to do. And I know that often I don't know what to do. I find myself in that position far too often than I'd like to admit. And maybe especially when I'm trying to pastor. You know, someone calls and they're in this situation and I don't have words. Things are tough. It's interesting. People call their pastors more often when things are going wrong than when things are going right. That's a different sermon. Maybe we could talk about that some other time. But yeah, that's part of my role, right? And I think in the same way that all of us who profess faith in Jesus Christ and We've been baptized. We've become the body of Christ, right? We're the hands and feet of Christ. That all of us, in this sense of kind of a priesthood of believers, can in any given moment be the presence of Christ in the life of someone particularly in need. But I imagine sometimes you find yourselves, like I find myself, being uncertain of what to say or what to do. And I think not only is that normal, but I think there's a way to be especially faithful in that moment. That faith, which kind of wraps up this whole Advent wreath, right? It's joy and peace and hope and love. I got them out of order, but it's like when I'm talking about my kids, right? So, joy and faith and hope and love, or joy and peace. Well, forget it. I'm really struggling today. Oh, I'm struggling, and so is the candle. He did it. I did. We'll see if it stays. My point is this, and I apologize for being unnecessarily opaque here. Faith is not about certainty. Faith is about active and humble attention. I got that phrase, active and humble attention, from Marilyn Robinson. She's a famous author, particularly that her book Gilead was very, very popular. I think she won the Pulitzer Prize. Pulitzer Prize for it. Surprise! But she's written some other things, and I was reading some of her work this week, and she said this. She said that she has, in her life, tried to cultivate some uncertainty. She said that she tried to cultivate uncertainty because she saw it as a form of reverence. Because to be overly certain is to kind of reduce God into something that's just manageable and kind of completely knowable. She said that actually to be certain was in some ways to be un-Christian, because to have faith is to have faith in an open, possible future that's beyond what we might know or imagine. So that God's kingdom, God's joy, God's peace, God's love, God's hope, what we have faith in is more than. God's more than what we can just know. God's more than what we can conceive. And so what we're called to is not a certainty, but an act of faith. Paul Tillich put it this way. He said that the opposite of faith is not doubt, but certainty. The opposite of faith is not doubt. We all have our doubts. You can doubt and be faithful. To doubt is just to be human. To doubt is to not know. To doubt is part of what that means, right? Because that's who we are. Ahaz had that, and so did Joseph. But the difference, I think, comes in this, is that Joseph practiced an active and humble attention. And that's what I think Advent is about. Do I want God to come? Yes. I mean, that's what Advent is all about. It's a waiting. Advent means coming, right? It's an expectation. Does God sometimes come to us in ways that resolves issues? Yes. Sometimes the sick are healed. Sometimes the brokenness is made right. Sometimes things work out. But other times, they don't. And sometimes the wait is really long. God promised Abraham that he would make his descendants a nation. Do you know when he fulfilled that promise? With the exodus of Egypt, when Moses led them out of captivity and made them a nation. Do you know the distance between the promise and the fulfillment? 400 years. That's a good strong stretch. That is a good long stretch. 400 years. My historians in the room, how old is the United States? 76. Nope. 245. All right, I'm going to trust you. He just got his PhD. He's got to be right. We're barely over halfway through the waiting period for that promise. Think of that. Another stretch. After the exile, God promised a Messiah. This passage, perhaps, Isaiah 7, is the promise of a birth of a child who will be God with us. 800 years between the events of Isaiah 7 and the events of Matthew 1. 800 years. That means that if we're to be a people of God, we have to be prepared to lean into faith, to be okay with uncertainty, and the promises that we're waiting on might be seen by our children's 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 children. It may not be seen by us, but that's what it means to be a part of this group of people. Back in March, a group of us from the church here went to Israel, and we were in the Garden of Gethsemane. And there were some olive trees there that were about 2,000 years old, which means that they were little seedlings when Jesus was making his way down the mountainside and stayed up all night to pray. That's pretty amazing. Those trees have been alive since Jesus prayed that prayer. A few months back, I made my way out to California for a business trip. And I stopped by the Mariposa Grove of Redwoods in Yosemite. There's some redwoods in the Mariposa Grove that were seedlings when Isaiah prophesied about the coming of the Messiah. They're 800 years older than the olive trees in the Garden of Gethsemane. Sometimes we just need to be farsighted. Like, we all suffer from a certain amount of kind of spiritual nearsightedness. Our spiritual nearsightedness enables us to see that which is right in front of us, but we can't see that which is far away. And that's what faith is. Faith is spiritual farsightedness. Faith is not knowing what's coming, being uncertain of what's right, but being faithful in it. And that's what we're called to do. When you came in this morning, there were these cards. He says, thanks, Sonny. Helping a pastor out. It says, on one side, God is with us. And on the other side, it says, even in the midst of. We titled this sermon today, A Clear and Present Hope. Which is funny, because mostly what I've talked about is about the lack of clarity. But this is what makes hope clear. Hope is clear because it's based on faith, not based on what we actually see. So what I want you to do is there are pens in the seat pockets, and I want you to think about what it is this year that you've struggled with. What is it this year that you felt you were kind of up against it? What is it this year that felt like an unfulfilled promise or an unrealized hope? Yeah? And I want you to write it on there, even in the midst of family struggles, even in the midst of sickness, even in the midst of job struggles, even in the midst of relationship struggles, even in the midst of. Because even in the midst of, we serve a God who is with us. We're going to, in a minute, after I've given you a chance to write, we're going to come to the table. And the way we're going to do it today is we're going to process, and I want you to bring your card with you, even in the midst of, whatever you filled out. And on the sides, even in the middle, if you don't mind, if everyone would kind of move out and go back, there is a tray at the back of the center aisle, and it's a place for you to kind of deposit your card. And then after you've placed it there, you'll come down the center aisle. We can make two rows, and then we'll have servers here to serve you communion. We'll have you kind of take communion at the table. We're eating at the table today. We're not carrying it back to the family room and watching on TV. So we'll come to the table and we'll eat. And then I'll come back a bit later and we'll close out the service. Even in the midst of. Maybe in the midst of a foreign army about to destroy your nation. Maybe in the midst of you finding out that your fiance is pregnant with somebody else's baby. I don't know. But I know that we've all are living in this world and that it has a brokenness, a fissure that runs all the way through, right down through our very hearts, through our very souls. So as you're ready, I'll ask you to go ahead and move. If you filled out your card, move out and around and come down the center aisle. The servers are coming now to prepare. This bread and this wine, as you know, are the body and blood of Christ. And we ask that the Lord would bless them. Bless them so that they might not just nourish our bodies, so that they might nourish our souls, so that we too might come and behold who we are and become what we receive.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in joy, sweet. spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to
Advent is a time to open the first pages of the church's story of salvation. It is an enchanted portal into a world of darkness, deep mystery, and the Spirit's hidden brooding. As we pray and wait, the Spirit begins to shed God's light upon our present darkness. Love overwhelms hate. Peace transforms anxiety. In Advent's light, the deep river that springs out of the life of God begins to flow in our lives, replacing our unbearable lightness with unspeakable joy. In this joy, we cry, "Even so, come, Lord Jesus."
Even in the midst of rapid job changes,
God is with us.
Even in the midst of my own fears, God is with us.
Even in the midst of a death of a friend,
God is with us. Even in the midst of mental illness, God is with us.
Even in the midst of my feelings of failure, God is with us.
Even in the midst of transforming our communication, God is with us.
Even in the midst of both despair and hope,
God is with us. Even in the midst of self-doubt, God is with us.
Even in the midst of trying to succeed in high school,
God is with us. Even in the midst of the death of my mom, my sister and I are now closer. God is with us. God is with us.
I found that exact quote from Marilynne Robinson, and I wanted to read it. She says, "There is something about certainty that makes Christianity unchristian." She continued a bit. She said, "I've cultivated uncertainty, which I consider a form of reverence. Reverence tells us that truth always utterly exceeds what we know or can know, even if that knowledge comes to us by revelation. This God with whom we have to do, this God whose thoughts are not our thoughts, claims from us, I believe, not static and confident belief, but active and humble attention." My prayer for all of us this last day of Advent, and as we go into the celebration of the birth of Christ on Wednesday, is that we might all have an active and humble attention to the presence of God, to Emmanuel, to the God who is with us. Amen. Amen. I want to remind you that we have the Christmas Eve candlelight service this Tuesday here at 5:30. And there was something else I was supposed to tell you, but it just goes with the rest. What's that?
Photo booth.
Photo booth. Thanks. Thank you, Lord. I heard you. We have a photo booth set up outside, and we invite you to kind of get some pictures kind of taken, kind of Christmas time. It'd just be a kind of fun thing to do. All right? I love you. Thanks for loving me back. Go in peace.